Hey everyone, thanks for joining me today for my very first episode of my new podcast, True Crime and Whatnot. My name is Tanya, and I am a bit of a true crime junkie, just to give you a little heads up about me. So, our first story today is going to be about the world of mobsters. Now, I'm using that term very lightly because I don't really consider them mobsters. I do consider them criminals, but after doing my research, I don't know that I completely agree with the way that their deaths were carried out. So, without further ado, let's just talk about the infamous Bonnie and Clyde. Warning, this story contains graphic detail of crime scenes and death. Viewer discretion is advised. Clyde Chestnut Barrow was born March 24th, 1909. He was first arrested at the ripe old age of 17 because he didn't turn in his rental car on time. That was in 1926. I didn't realize until I did this research that rental cars were even a thing then. So imagine the shock of finding out he was arrested for not turning it in. He was later arrested with his brother, Buck, for possession of stolen turkeys. Yes, turkeys. The actual bird. Not frozen. Still with its head. Remember, Buck, because he comes back around later. Okay? Okay. Clyde had a few legit jobs from 1927 to 1929, but apparently they weren't paying enough for him, so he would crack safes, rob stores, steal cars, you know, kind of like, for the time, pretty petty stuff. Now, Bonnie Elizabeth Parker was born October 1st, 1910. I didn't find out a whole lot about her before Clyde came into her life, other than she married Roy Thornton on September 25th, 1926, when she was only 16. Now, I know what you're thinking. She was a child. But back then, women married very, very young. And honestly, most died very young due to illness or complications with childbirth. So it wasn't unusual for young couples to go ahead and start their lives together. However, Roy Thornton was a convicted murderer. So Bonnie, you know, she's already shown great taste in men. Yeah. After Roy was arrested in January of 1929, they never saw each other again. They also never, they never divorced. Clyde and Bonnie were introduced to each other when she was 19 through a mutual friend, and they just really hit it off. The romance was short-lived. Clyde was arrested yet again for auto theft. And in April of 1930, Clyde was sent to Eastham Prison Farm. And while in prison, Clyde was allegedly repeatedly sexually assaulted. And eventually he retaliated by attacking and killing his tormentor by beating him with a pipe and crushing his skull. Yeah. Violent, right? That was his first murder. But another inmate claimed it, since he was already serving a life sentence. And, you know, I don't know if I should look at that as that was nice of that prisoner, or that was him just trying to take the glory for it. But either way, Clyde let him take the blame, and he moved on with his life. Now, in January of 1932, he chopped off two toes to avoid hard labor in the fields. Yeah, chopped them off. Now, I couldn't find what he cut them off with, but with the term chopped, my mind goes to axe. Could have been a scythe, since it was a farm. Could have been a pickaxe. It's really hard to say. But the worst part is, unbeknownst to him, his mother was lobbying for his release. And he was paroled 6 days after the toe thing, on February 2nd, 1932. But now Clyde has went from a sweet and gentle man to a hardened and very bitter criminal. People that knew him before he went in said he wasn't the same man that went into the prison, which, given the circumstances, if you're being taunted and harassed and assaulted every single day, it changes you. It changes your mind. It changes the way you see people, and it changes the way that you see yourself. So I don't think killing his attacker is what changed him, but the events leading up to that. But that's my personal opinion. Let me know what you think. Now, soon after he got out of prison, he met back up with Miss Bonnie, and a short time later, the chaos began. And by the time of their deaths, nearly 2 years later, they were suspected of 13 murders, 2 kidnappings, several robberies, and auto thefts. They would become the most infamous couple of all time. So just to give you a little rundown of a timeline of events, it all started around April 30th of 1932 when store owner J.N., I'm probably going to butcher his name, which I think that's his last name, Butcher, was shot and killed during a robbery. His wife identified Clyde as one of the shooters, even though Clyde was only the getaway driver. August 5th of 1932, Clyde, Ray Hamilton, and Ross Dyer were drinking moonshine at a dance in Stringtown, Oklahoma, when Sheriff C.G. Maxwell and Deputy Eugene C. Moore approached them in the parking lot. The trio then opened fire, killing Deputy Moore and seriously wounding Sheriff Maxwell. Deputy Moore was the first officer of 9 to be killed by Clyde and the gang. October 11th, 1932, the gang allegedly killed Howard Hall during a robbery at his store in Sherman, Texas. And I say allegedly because historians are really disputing this story, just due to lack of evidence that they were even in that area at the time. It's said that they were in another state altogether. I think Louisiana, if I remember correctly. But, you know, that's one that's always going to be up in the air. We're never going to fully know the depths of what these people did. But anyway, back to the timeline. November 1932, Ray Hamilton leaves the gang and is soon replaced on Christmas Eve, Merry Christmas, right, by William Daniel Jones, whom at the time was, about the ripe old age of, I think he had just turned 16, and he had known Clyde most of his childhood. Clyde was a family friend, and he really looked up to Clyde, so to get a chance to travel with him and just hang out with him was just the best thing ever for him. Christmas Day, the next day, 1932, William Jones and the gang murdered Doyle Johnson while stealing his car in Temple. I believe that's Temple, Oklahoma. I believe. It could be Temple, Texas. There's several. There are several. And most of the information that I am getting and giving to you is from the FBI file that I found. And it doesn't specify a state. So I'm assuming it's Temple, Oklahoma. I'm probably wrong. January 6th, 1933, Clyde kills Tarrant County Deputy Malcolm Davis when the gang wandered into a trap set for another criminal. The police had them several times, and they just wandered away. That's just how they did. March 23rd, 1933, Ivan Barrow, also known as Buck, was released from Texas State Prison on a full pardon. So if you're wondering what a pardon is, that's basically you're released, and it's kind of like it's wiped from your record. So it's like you didn't commit a crime. So he was released on a full pardon in March of 1933. And then he joined Bonnie and Clyde and made it an even bigger family affair by bringing his wife, Blanche, along for the ride. Poor Blanche. I don't think she really knew what she was getting into. And I don't think Buck really knew either. Because some of the accounts that I did find stated that he wasn't actually there to join the gang. He was there to try to talk them into turning themselves in. And it kind of didn't work. It backfired big time. And you're going to find out why here in just a minute. Because on April 13th, 1933, police assembled a 5-man crew on to confront who they assumed were bootleggers. It was Clyde, Buck, and Jones, and Bonnie and Blanche. And the men opened fire, killing Detective Harry L. McGinnis and fatally wounding Constable J.W. Harriman. I'm not really sure how you say that. the gang was able to escape, but they left behind almost everything they owned, including Buck's parole papers, a poem written by Bonnie, and several rolls of undeveloped film that would finally put a face to the names. Because at this point, the public didn't know what they looked like. They just knew their names, and they knew who they were looking for. Now they had a face, and it was not going to be good for Bonnie, because up until this point, everybody thought that Bonnie was a victim, and that she was just this woman in love with this terrible man, and he was dragging her along, and the pictures portrayed a totally different woman. She's smoking cigars, which was very taboo at the time, and she's holding weapons and pointing them at the men, and you can tell that she is just as guilty as they were, which was unheard of at the time. So imagine people's shock when they see these pictures of this woman. Now, at some point in May of 1933, we're already a year into this, they attempt a bank robbery in Lucerne, Indiana, and then they ended up in Okabena, Minnesota, where they robbed a bank. So they attempted a bank robbery in Lucerne, didn't get anywhere with that. So they go to Minnesota and they rob a bank. Somehow along the way, they managed to get to Ruston, Louisiana. These people move fast. They moved to Ruston, Louisiana, where they kidnapped a local undertaker by the name of Dillard Darby, and his, I guess she was his girlfriend at the time, Sophia Stone, while stealing his car. Now, according to Darby, when Bonnie found out he was an undertaker, she responded with, "Maybe one day you'll work on me." How weird would that be? Right? Right? Isn't that a little morbid? I mean, you're telling them that you know you're gonna die doing this. That's just odd, I guess, for me. Now, typically they would release their captives far from home, but they would give them plenty of money to help them get back home. So they had cash, and they were able to get home, and they were pretty nice to their captives, from what I was reading. They, you know, tried to be friends with them, tried to make nice, and the only thing that they ever asked was that you tell the people about Bonnie and Clyde. They wanted the story of their lives to be told. Interesting. On May 20th, 1933, the Dallas, Texas commissioner issued a warrant for Bonnie and Clyde's arrest due to interstate transportation of a stolen vehicle from Dallas to Oklahoma. On June 10th, 1933, we're halfway through the year. Clyde missed the signs for a bridge under construction near Wellington, Texas. The car flipped into a ravine, and Bonnie sustained third-degree burns on her right leg from her hip to her ankle. Now, It's unknown if the burns were from battery acid or a fire that happened in the vehicle, but according to one of the people that was there, the burns were so severe they caused her right leg to draw up, and in some places it was burned so badly you could see the bone. And from that point on, Bonnie would either hop or she would be carried by Clyde. She never walked again. And they couldn't take her to a hospital because they were known. So they had to be very careful about what they did. They couldn't stay in hotels anymore. They couldn't stay in and rent homes. They couldn't go out to eat at the local restaurants that were available. They had to camp. They literally had to camp. There was no rest. So July 29th, 1933, Buck is fatally wounded during a shootout in Iowa. And Blanche is also wounded and captured. Now, I also read that Buck lived for a while after being shot in the head. And he even ate meals, laughed, and joked with all of them. I'm not going to go into great detail about his injury because it was really gruesome, according to W.D. Jones. And what I read about it, it was pretty gross. And it's not even how he actually died. He actually died because the police found them camping and he was dead weight, so they didn't take him with them. And he and Blanche got left behind. And that's how they got captured and how he ended up dying. He actually tried to shoot the police and he ended up getting shot himself. Now, November 22nd, the Dallas Sheriff's Department set a trap to capture the gang. But once again, they escaped. And in January of 1934, five prisoners were quote unquote liberated from the Eastham State Prison Farm in Waldo, Texas, by Clyde. Two of the prison guards were shot during the escape by guns hidden by Clyde. Among the so-called liberated was a man by the name of Henry Methvin, and none other than Mr. Ray Hamilton. Remember him from way back when they first started? Yeah, same guy. Turns out he was serving over a 200-year sentence. Needless to say, his life didn't get any better when he left the gang. So, yeah, you know, so here they are. They're trying to get him out, and sounds like he really needs to be in jail at this point. I couldn't find what he was serving the 200-year sentence for, but it was probably murder. On April 4th, 1934, two young highway patrolmen were shot by Bonnie and Clyde before they could even draw their guns. April 6th, 1934, they kill a constable and wound a police chief that they had abducted in Miami, Oklahoma. They kidnapped the police chief. Because they're brilliant. Okay. That's what that is. That's brilliant. Not really. Please don't do that. That's not... No. That's not safe. On April 13th, 1934, the FBI had an agent in the area of Ruston, Louisiana, because they like to hang out there. And this agent obtained information that placed Bonnie and Clyde in a remote area southwest of the community. And at this point, Henry Methvin and his family lived around that area, just on the outskirts. Now, remember Henry, he was one of the men that Clyde helped break out of prison. So, should have left him. So, at the same time that agent in Texas found out where they were traveling back and forth from Texas to Louisiana, and occasionally with Henry Methvin, local law enforcement and FBI were able to get information that let them know Bonnie, Clyde, and some of the Methvin family had staged a party in Black Lake, Louisiana for May 21st, 1934. And they'd be due back in that area on May 23rd. The area of Ruston, Louisiana. So before dawn, the morning of May 23rd, 1934, a posse of 6 lawmen hid in the bushes along the highway near Sales, Louisiana. Bonnie and Clyde were killed in a hail of gunfire that morning. Police emptied their entire ammo on the car, which came to about 130 rounds. Clyde died instantly with a shot to the head. One officer recalled Bonnie screaming. And according to the coroner, Bonnie was shot at least 26 times, while Clyde was shot 17. And the undertaker stated it was extremely difficult to embalm the bodies because of all the bullet wounds, if that gives you an idea of what they look like after they were done. And I just kind of imagine, for lack of better aesthetics, I imagine Jim Carrey in The Mask when they shoot him with the machine gun and he drinks the wine and or the champagne and it's like spraying out all over. That's what I imagine the embalming fluid doing. So it's not funny. I'm so sorry. It is not funny. But my thought process of what they look like is what I'm laughing about. So there are a lot of details that are just so disgusting and disturbing in this situation. And one of them is the lack of any control of the area where they were killed. The people, they were allowed to come and see, and they were allowed to get to the bodies. They cut hair from their bodies, swatches from their clothes. They stole glass from the windows in the vehicle, and 2 men even tried to cut off parts of Clyde's body. The fact that they were cold-blooded killers does not escape me. It doesn't. But they didn't deserve that. No one does. Where were the trials? Where was the justice? Because I understand the officers involved were worried about the whole them or us mentality. They had to have that mentality. But they acted more out of rage and fear than out of justice. And many people feel as though they were murdered by the posse. And honestly, it is so easy for us to sit here almost 100 years later with all the information and say what should have been done differently. I'm not condoning what anyone has done in this case, so please don't think that. I believe the officers acted with the best of their knowledge and in the only way they thought would ensure they went home that night. You gotta remember, these were known cop killers. So, I don't think that their plan went the way they wanted it to. Do I think Bonnie and Clyde deserved a trial? Absolutely. Do I think that they would have had one? No. I also don't think they would have received a fair trial. I do think, given their histories and things that she had written and they had said, I think they went out the way they wanted to, together and in a blaze of glory. I mean, look, we still talk about their story today. There are movies, books, songs, plays still being written about them to this day. They're immortalized by those of us who just want to understand what was going on in their minds. Because, why would you kidnap a chief of police? I mean, that's not smart. It's just not smart. And the law was so different then, and they didn't have the ability to do the things that they do now. So it's just curious. So to this day, they're still the most notorious crime couple ever, at least in U.S. history. I think in the world, but definitely U.S. history. But that, my dear friends, brings us to the end of the Bonnie and Clyde saga. Now, if you enjoyed the story, please let me know by liking my podcast and even sharing them with your friends. I'm currently working on an Instagram page and a couple things like that. Once I get all that set up, I'll let you know. So you can make sure to like, follow, and subscribe. But join me again soon for another true crime and whatnot story. I'll see you soon. Bye.